We are Adrian Alves Kennis, and we make reconstructions of humans. And we started because we were very bad at school. We were not good in mathematics, and we were not good in reading. So the only thing we could do was making drawings of faces and about animals and everything. And the first, I show you two examples of the first reconstructions we made. There are those two. On the left, for you on the right, you see clearly Cro-Magnon. This is a Cro-Magnon man. And on the left side for you, you see clearly a Peking man. And especially when we came in the library, there were not so many books about human ancestors. But one illustrator stick out. And there was this illustrator, Zdeněk Burian from Czechia. And he made this beautiful, rough reconstructions of, for example, Neanderthals. I mean, we were fascinated by it because we liked the characters, we liked the rough style. With my parents, we went on vacation to Germany and to Italy, and we traveled through these landscapes Burian often depicted, because Adrien and I weren't so fascinated by dinosaurs, because dinosaurs was much too alien, much too far away.
Reptiles have no character.
And we could not imagine a world with only reptiles. We could imagine a world with humans in it, and then with strange beasts in it, like woolly rhinos, cave bears, even cave lions. And we were fascinated by this world where people lived, primitive people walked around, and where they could encounter big lions, big mammoths. How do you make reconstructions? First, you need a skull. We often get casts of skulls, if you made casts ourselves, or if you want to reconstruct the total body, we get bags of all elements of mostly pieces of human skeletons. And these pieces we try to put together to reconstruct in a complete skeleton. And for example, here you got a skull and it's missing its face, and we got only a couple of bits of the face. So we look in our big spare part collection behind me. We have an enormous collection here on skulls. In the drawers are also postcranial stuff and are in it. Here you can all kind of bones and pelvis pieces.
It's our garage.
We're gonna look in our collection. What type of human is this? How old is it? You have to know, of course. And what type is it? And then we look in our collection if you find other individuals from the same time frame. And then we're gonna look at it. What our bits have the same type of morphology. And then we try to recreate more or less the face.
This is
the end result of the reconstruction of this face. So we use this one as base. We have this part and all those loose parts. And then we create a new face. If you see carefully, you see that the maxilla, here's the left maxilla of this face is put here in this part. And the nasal area, we've used also this piece from Atapuerca, we use here. So we create a new face.
But nowadays, last reconstructions are more made with stereolithography. They scan the bones, so it's not necessary we have to do this to make casts of the originals. So we scan, the bones are scanned nowadays, And we at home we got a 3D printer, and you can print out the bones without have to use silicones on the originals. It's even today possible to make a reconstruction from a skull who is still in situ, embedded in calcite in the cave. This one is from Altamura, and we got they managed to scan the skull in the cave, embedded in calcite. And then we printed out this skull, and then we were able to make a reconstruction. So this is the result of the skull, and you see these small pecs here in the face, and those pecs resemble the skin thickness in this part of the face. So if you see here on the cheeks, you see bigger pecs, longer pecs, because there's a lot of more fat tissue and bigger muscles, especially here, of KGS. And this side, here you see the big mas-eater, the mas-eater muscle for chewing. And the big temporal muscle here, and the chewing, and you see that this pack is rather long because the muscle is very thick. On the nose, the skin is very thin, and there are no muscles, not so much muscles on it, small ones. So you see the packs, the tissue thickness is very small, it's very not so big. To guide us with the reconstruction, and especially to choose the right muscle size and how the muscles are, we look at dead corpses. We dissect dead corpses of chimps, and also we can look at institutes where they have dead bodies of people, so we can recreate the muscles from modern humans. So these muscles guide us with the reconstruction of these in between human ancestors, who are a little bit ape-like in the face, probably also, especially the oldest ones, but they become more human-like. So we have to look more at the human of the human muscles. You must imagine, we live indoors all the time nowadays, people. These people, you must imagine, people 100, 200 years ago, people who worked on the land, work in the orchards and things. I know people who worked on the farms. They were in the summer, they got tanned very quick. So people who live outdoors all the time, and especially in the summer, look probably pretty dark. And that's why on Neanderthals, Neanderthals, we make all kind of skin tests. And this one looks like a very, this skin test is much too pale for a Neanderthal. It was just a test, it was a failure, we have hundreds of failures. But this one was too pale. And so we try, this is not an individual, but we try to do different colors to make it darker, so it looks more like a guy who is living outdoors all the time. We built our colors inside out. So we start with the darkest pigmentation, where real people maybe also have the darkest spot, the darkest layers. And then superficial layers. And then we make color layer after layer, more layers. And why more layers? Because then you see nice different colors in the face. You also see with this guy here, this is the guy from Jebel Irut. It's the one of the first Homo sapiens 300,000 years ago. If you see our skin color here, it's a bit, there's a variation in color. Here's more orange, here's more purple, dark, here's more blackish. So if you use more layers, it looks more realistic. In films and everything, you see this kind of stuff. These are very neat. These are the first Europeans the first Africans who come into Europe. They look very neat. Look very like a six-pack and muscled,
idealistic people. Also, the woman has the clothes on the right spot. But why, if we look at, if we see human evolution, we look at people, look at anthropological pictures, and we see like this kind of stuff, this kind of. Why not like this?
Yeah, instead of this.
And these ethnographic photographs inspire us to see how this ancient world of a prehistoric man was. This is a world very long ago, mostly beyond our imagination, because we Adrie and I and a lot of people in this place are grown up in the Western world with a Western civilization. But this guy next to us looks for us a bit nearly alien for us compared strange. with this European guy. Strange, but for him, in his world, he's normal, and this is abnormal. Yeah. So if we try to make a reconstruction, we try to gonna dive in this world. If we were maybe in a Western museum, if we think Western, you see his testicles are hanging under the shell. But if we put him in a normal museum, we put the shell over his testicles for sure. But this guy doesn't feel naked. This guy feels himself normal. He doesn't feel naked. He stands
in his world. Yeah.
This is, in his world, this is a nice piece of necklace here on his belly. Museum directors can have big problems with it to confront people who are gonna visit with children and families.
Nakedness.
To this naked guy can have some problems. And our culture was 100 years, not 100 years ago. It's also a bit weird because if you walk on the streets this way nowadays, I think people would.
It's not that different than this guy.
Yeah. We also do kind of contrast in it. If you see this nice picture of a nice woman, nice child is hanging on the breast, is a nice female body. But suddenly, if you see it under her face, she is smoking a cigarette, and she's a bit. It looks more like a male who's kind of cigarette. So you get two things in one view. You get a female like under side in this picture, and you get a male for robust. Yeah, but it makes nice contrast, and that makes it authentic.
Smoking.
We have to reconstruct a robust guy, and we see also robust guys in ethnographic photographs, then they don't stand robust, they don't feel robust, they don't stand as a Hulk. So this Neanderthal, we made the reconstruction. You see, it's very robust, an enormous broad pelvis, incredible broad pelvis, short legs. But he stands very relaxed. He stands not as a Hulk, I'm a strong man. He can be shy, he can be a shy Neanderthal.
Introvert.
And this, we also make sure that he makes contacts. It was also a bit nice to do that the reconstruction make contact with the visitor. So our reconstruction always look at you. So you get a really the feeling you engage an ancestor, you engage somebody.
Yeah, here we see an Homo sapiens, the earliest Homo sapiens. It's a Homo sapiens of 300,000 years old, it's for Jebel Irut. It has a rough haircut, it has a rough face. It has a strong body, but it's rather thin, but a strong body. So what we thought, we saw pictures of females who are making themselves pretty. And we thought, why could this guy not make himself pretty?
Put some stripes on his body.
White stripes on his body. So he's doing kind of maybe a female thing, of what we think of a female thing. But his head is very robust, so you have, again, nice contrast.
This is the way how people stand and behave and stand if you have no pockets. You leave your hands somewhere, and even very primitive old human ancestors walked erect,
have their hands free, but leave the, if they just staring at something,
relaxed pose,
they leave their hands somewhere. And it's very interesting on ethnographic photographs to see where people leave their hands if they have no pockets.
They do not the active pose, like hunting, right, or like
making, try to avoid it. Yeah.
Try to avoid it, of making tools, because then you don't, they have no connection with the hominid, the connection with the public, and you don't see the anatomy very well.
We make a lot of reconstructions, so for each time, for us, the face has to be interesting. So what we normally like to do is building a contrast in the face and for over a kind of tension in the face. And for example here, this child, this Neanderthal child, has a rather big mouth. She's a bit, little bit laughing at you, she's a bit laughing, but it's not a complete easy laugh, it's not complete easy to see. It's still hiding in the face where the laugh will burst out. But she's still in a phase before. She's not laughing right out. The same have we done with this face. This boy, there's a boy in Neanderthal, a bit older. But she also, he's not laughing right out. It's just, there's something starts to happen in this face.
You can see two examples, some sketches, two sketches. They look very similar. It's a very nice face, a bit. Woman, but there is also a nice contrast in the face. You see here, for us, we think a rather aggressive nose, with the nostrils turned upwards. Then maybe we put some friendly eyes above it, and we give her a friendly smile. So we get a nice contrast with a bit aggressive like nose and a friendly smile. And sometimes we go too far, we can go too far. This is another sketch. And here, she puts the mouth a bit already open. But we think then, when we make this thing, that is too much because the mouth is open. You go and look now also at the nose and at the mouth, but the mouth attracts too much attention from the nose. So that's why we prefer to do the mouth closed. So it's you see nice contrast of the aggressive nose and the friendly face. Thank you.